Welcome, everyone, to our monthly seminar and to our guest, Dimitri Kusnezov, I think, who's known to many of us here. He was chief scientist for NNSA. Most important, he was special advisor or advisor or something like that to the secretary a few years ago. That was very convenient. And now he's deputy undersecretary for artificial intelligence and technology, or some long title like that. I've known Dimitri actually for quite some time, since we were in the same field when he was on the faculty at Yale University, some postdoc in between, but following a PhD in theoretical nuclear physics, an excellent field, from Princeton. And then, of course, being in the DOE system, we've known Dimitri quite well. And in fact, I'll just tell one story that when Dimitri was serving as advisor to me as secretary, one of the arenas, of course, Dimitri has been long involved in advanced computational issues, for example, but also in this time period, the applications of advanced computational methods to some of the biological problems that we have to address at DOE was quite a prominent place for us and a third person, Steve Binkley, to work together. But then when Vice President Biden announced the cancer moonshot that he was put in charge of, the Vice President has noted many times that the first agency that contacted him to help was DOE. And it was because we understood that there could be a novel approach using very, very large-scale data analytics, merging very, very different data sets, like clinical data, genomic data, environmental data, for patients. And in fact, Veterans Affairs gave us both money and large amounts of information that is resident at Oak Ridge National. I assume it's still there at Oak Ridge National Laboratory for this application. So when I went to see the Vice President, Dimitri was with me. In fact, he stayed after I left, and the Vice President was kind of like head over heels over the idea that A, we went there, and B, we had an original idea, which I think will still be proved out to be, I think, quite important. I must say that, as an aside, I also think that the large data analytics in this arena may be the key to finally solving a very important problem for the Department of Energy: low-dose radiation. Certainly, the traditional approaches have gotten us not very far, shall we say, over a long time. And it may be that this is all about big data kinds of approaches and finding, you know, needle in the haystack kind of thing. So anyway, just to say that with Dimitri, certainly, we've had a lot of interesting times together. Artificial intelligence is clearly providing many opportunities and roiling many systems as well. And I think it's interesting that Dimitri's title now explicitly includes artificial intelligence. And I think today he's going to tell us about artificial intelligence at the DOE, science programs, energy programs, and national security programs. Dimitri, welcome.
Thank you. It's great to see you again. It's nice to be here. Thank you for the opportunity to share what we're trying to do. I have one further anecdote to build on your cancer moonshot. I do remember there were a lot of meetings that year. One in particular had the president and the vice president when he looked over and nicknamed you Big Daddy Data. Just something that you might want to use at some point. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about how we're thinking about artificial intelligence today. There is a lot of buzz and hype and overselling and underselling and everything swirling around. I want to tell you with a little more precision what we're thinking about, what we categorize this with technology-wise, what it maps onto in terms of our mission, why we think it's important, some of the vulnerabilities, and we'll see where we go. You know, I don't have to say too much, but I just always need a slide about DOE because a lot of people understand parts of what we do, but not everything. And it's always good to remind the context. As a mission agency, we're trying to get things done. You know, we're doing things on schedules. There are important statutory responsibilities. You know, Department of Everything or Department of Modeling or various other names could be also apropos. We have a national lab system that helps us do this. We do research that's focused on the outcomes. When you think about some of the areas that we're responsible for, you know, such as the energy sector, protecting it against all hazards, man-made and natural, not just the grid. We have all kinds of classified and unclassified networks, so we have cybersecurity responsibilities. We have certainly physical security issues. You certainly know the nuclear weapons and non-proliferation missions. Emergency preparedness and response broadly, intelligence functions, strategic petroleum reserve, loan programs, collections of things with research kind of unevenly split between them as we think of them, but all of them increasingly replete with data and interesting challenges that I'd like to get to. You know, we solve problems typically that no one else can because if we could, we'd simply buy them off the shelf. And we have the national lab structure and the infrastructure for those classes of problems that no one else knows how to do. And we throw, you know, significant team science efforts and facilities behind them with focus. As a consequence, we're drawn into a lot of peripheral problems. Because of this capability, because we can turn on a dime and answer hard questions, you know, from the Gulf oil spill to Fukushima, the Tom, I still remember you in your gym shorts all day because you were working out in the gym when you got the alert, and then you were sucked into meetings the entire day there. That was in March of that year, and you know, till the late at night, you stayed in your shorts. You know, but these things happen, and we're able to do some fairly remarkable things because we have an infrastructure that many people don't quite understand. And core to what we do has been simulation, because we guard against rare events. We place bets in terms of where we push limited money to buy down risks in all of these kinds of problems. We can't do everything. We have to understand what are most critical. These are things that we hope never happen, so they're not well instrumented, they're not well predicted, and so we have to figure out how we get our heads around some of these hard problems. And so virtualizing them, we've been rooted in the model-based prediction world for years, but increasingly in the last few years, there's this parallel world of data-centered decision-making that we're starting to dip our toes in fairly strongly. Secretary Perry set up a new program office to help coordinate this across the department and help drive it, and he asked me to lead this, which is what I've started to get my head around recently. You know, to say a few words about AI first, well, first it's just about everywhere. You know, you deal with it in your daily lives, whether it's Siri or Alexa or Cortana, whether it's map functions and traffic patterns, whether you're using Skype now, which I think this year will have 60 languages of live translation, you know, whether you want to figure out where a photo is taken, you can geotag it by just using one of these engines that looks at photos, and it'll tell you where in the world this beach or this tree or this street is likely from, and it'll tag a few places or it'll identify it. You know, it's in so many different places right now in routine but very narrow definitions, and we need something broader. I would say it's disruptive. multidisciplinary. It's different than analytics. In analytics, you give instruction to a computer to look for something. You're very specific. It follows the instructions, and that's what you get. In machine learning, in that part of AI, and I'll get to that in a moment, you have methods to find patterns in data, and you don't know necessarily what you're going to find. You don't tell it what to look for. It surfaces relationships in complex data sets. You have to determine whether they're real or not, but it surfaces answers to questions you didn't know to ask because you didn't know they were in the data. And so you don't have to know what you're looking for. You can try and surface some of these things through these kinds of methods. And so the instructions and the approaches are different than analytics in a fundamental way. But it's being applied everywhere. It is a massive undertaking in just about every economic sector. Goals are to augment or supplement human capabilities. I mean, these days we're all buried in data, in our emails, in the information overload that we get increasingly. The kinds of data we deal with can be petabytes of data per day. For example, in cyber, and I'll get to that again in a moment. Petabyte, imagine a billion photographs coming in every day on your iPhone. That's about a petabyte. And imagine you had to surface relevant information from that every day. You know, how many analysts does that take you? You know, there are things that already there is a crush of data and information. And the way we've often managed this now is to pick your battles. We have this many people. I can look at this kind of data. So this is where I'm going to wager is the most relevant, but you actually don't know. And there are smarter ways to do this. There are smarter ways to augment what humans could do, looking at data richer, deeper, more complex, and ask questions of it. You might get things totally unexpected. They might be wrong. They might not be causally related, but it's up to you to figure that out. But anyway, you can go through data and surface information with the goal of effectively reverse engineering knowledge from data. You know, that's the goal, which is different than where we've been in model-based prediction for many years. When I think about AI, I think about it in a kind of a taxonomy here. First, where does the data come from? You have to ingest it somehow. Smart sensors, detectors, how you get images or voice or signals or text. What is the intake, smart intake of relevant information? You get data, then what? How do you learn from it? So let's say you aggregate a massive amount of data. The next step is machine learning, learning algorithms, things like deep learning, very computationally taxing, but ways to surface patterns in your data. There are various approaches to doing that, but really you surface questions in the data that you didn't know to ask. The other issue after that is how do you make a decision based on that? How do you know it's real? How do you know it's the most relevant thing? And that's not trivial. We've refined that in the nuclear weapons business. We have something called uncertainty quantification. We apply it to nuclear weapons when we do the annual assessment process. It is not a mathematical approach. It is a human in the loop, very complicated. How you aggregate how you aggregate uncertainties from many different sources to give an overall confidence on weapons performance, on their reliability, on their safety, security, and so forth. Deciding and proving in AI is not being really done. There isn't a lot of market for that. It's something we will care about. If you're going to make decisions, you have to know. We care about autonomy, automation, robotics, autonomous systems, how you interact with AI. AI typically lives in data-rich environments, and you need to apply to the source of the data. And there are many different things, for example, in machine learning, and in some parts of this come in natural language processing, in learning from data, speech, vision, robotics, and so on. So when we think of AI, we're thinking very broadly from from where the data comes from to how what you learn, how you automate, how you push it into the field, how you make decisions improve. And so it's a very broad umbrella from the point of view of technology, from the point of view of things it touches, but it's very generic. Right? This is not specific to any particular data domain. I threw this in just to kind of, we're in the business of high performance computing, HPC. Forgive me for the acronyms. I just want to say the world of artificial intelligence includes the machine learning piece and a deep learning piece beyond that. As subsets, it has an intersection with high-performance computing because we can solve some fairly remarkable AI problems today on our big systems, but they don't intersect exactly. They're not the same thing. There's also a field of data science, understanding data, when it's complete, when it's incomplete, how you think about structures of data. And so when we think about all the different technologies, there is a breadth of tools, expertise, things ideally suited to national labs, because we have our footprints in many of these areas. So when do we turn to something like machine learning? When would you say, well, I've got this problem, machine learning is the right thing to do? Often when we think patterns are in the data, but we don't know what they are. You're simply faced with data and you'd like to say, well, you know, what's in there? How do I approach that? We don't start with models. You know, this is opposite to how we solve problems on our big computers. On our big computers today, fairly significant one, the exascale mission that former secretary started us down. You know, we're spending billions of dollars on this. It is an important part of our workload today. We start with physical models. We know the question we're trying to answer. We write it down mathematically. We map it onto the architecture of a computer.
Just out of curiosity, what's the current exascale timeline?
2021, 22.
Still.
Change, yeah. So we build our models. We ask a question mathematically. We design computers with the intention of solving that problem. And so the computer knows what it's trying to answer. And there isn't a lot of data coming in. It generates a lot of data, but this world here, when we're doing learning, we don't have any mathematical relationships. We don't know. There are no models to start with. We simply have data. So we don't know what the relationships are. We don't know what the relevant degrees of freedom is. We start with a high-dimensional space full of data, whether it's all of your health records and all your genomic data and EKG traces, and let's say you pooled all of that together and you added 23andMe and whatever else, and you say, well, what's in there? You know, there is no model to start there. It's a soup of data. The question is, what do you do with that? Well, that's a place you turn to machine learning. Machine learning tries to extract a lower dimensional, simpler representation of all the data. So one of the goals is you start with this complicated data set, you run through it, it tells you these are the relevant few things to worry about. Maybe instead of a million different variables, you have 10. You distill the 10, and then you try and reconstruct the initial data from those 10. If they're really the dominant degrees of freedom, you can work backwards. So you try and extract the reduced model of what is relevant in your data so you can recreate the full set from those. And that seems to work. You know, some of these, there are all kinds of pictures like this. This is just a generic picture of learning. You know, naively how it works, you take a picture of a face or a cat and you look at the pixels. And then you look for relationships. What two pixels are next to each other? Can you define edges? So two light pixels next to each other or two dark ones. So the first passes through, you look at all the data, all the pixels come in, you look for relationships between them, you find edges, and then you try and find corners. And then you try and find extended objects. Maybe it's an ear or an eye or a nose, and you start to build features and structures from the data by repeatedly iterating and iterating in a very black box method that eventually surfaces faces. And you can apply this to all kinds of data, but naively it is churning through iterations and iterations of data trying to surface relationships in them. And when you think back to DOE's mission, so how does AI, in how I've described it, overlay with it? When you look across a number of different places in DOE, from the applied offices to our power marketing administrations, to science and nuclear security, they're actually just about everywhere. I mean, so we own about 10% of the grid in the U.S. It's, you know, tens of thousands of miles of power lines. We don't have a research program there because 96% of the revenues, for example, from the Western Area Power Administration come from utilities. So they don't, you know, a rate hike is the only way to generate research revenue, and no one really likes those. The Western Area Power Administration is about the size of Europe. The administrator there likes to characterize it as Paris to Moscow, Athens to Oslo, geographically. In that space, we have 319 power substations. 250 of them have instrumentation to monitor physical security. When temperatures get hot in regions of that space, high tension lines sag, you can lose 20% of transmission efficiency. People look at temperature maps and make a best guess on how you would redistribute power to not overdrive the system. You have funny market variances over this. So, for example, you'll have negative pricing in California and positive in Nevada, which means you have to pay California per megawatt to dump power into the state, and it's not the case in Nevada. And so there are market forces there, too, that are part of this. And the way they run this, for example, in preventive maintenance, they fly helicopters physically over the lines and take high-resolution video, MPEG files, and store them. At any given point in space, it's like once every 4 months, they will cover it. They'll take the videos, and then someone later will analyze them to look to see if the poles are leaning, if the guide wires are frayed, if there's some need for maintenance. They have operations center where people work 24-hour shifts looking at these things and making this. And you could easily imagine ways to automate this. If you were flying an autonomous system over high tension wires with AI smart sensors with change detection that were trained on the previous images, you might be able to detect when things are leaning, frayed, broken, and streamline the process there. If you thought about physical security and modalities there, better than having people stare at monitors and think about, did something happen today or this week, if you were more smartly coupled to where maintenance was being done, to what was going on in the system, and you again were running change detection or other smarter AI sensors, you could easily ingest relevant data to trigger on things that are real signals that you should worry about. And so it's not too hard as you think about the entry-level AI and the technologies, and as they map into the things that we do. I talked about cybersecurity and the petabytes per day of data that are coming in. Scientific discovery, for the IG, it's fraud detection. Emergency response and preparedness, if we're staging equipment, if you can take census data and topography and weather data and transportation networks and pipelines and overlay all of this with real-time information, you could probably learn the best ways to pre-position things as you try and regain and stand the grid back up if something bad were going to happen. There's smarter ways to think about the data fusion piece and how we learn, and this is the challenge right now. When we think about all of the missions, and I could talk at length about any of these, and there are more of them, of course, finding a way to holistically look at this from the point of view of the department is the challenge. How do we think about this? At the core of it, the infrastructure is likely going to be the same. But how do we organize ourselves to attack these problems in a way that makes sense? And why is today relevant? What's different today? You know, AI is 70 years old. It's from the 40s. It's from the start of the high-performance computing days as well. It happened around the same time. why, there isn't anything we're doing today that is really different than what we could have done 10 years ago or more. What's different is data, the ability to aggregate, store, measure, image, sense. Data right now is remarkable. Anyone can do it. You know, it doesn't take data farms. You know, phones today are getting towards a terabyte of storage on your phone. You know, when you think about what you can do at home, what you can do in a business, the amount of data that is collectible is amazing. It's cheap, and it's everywhere. And so the ubiquity of data is an essential piece, and we didn't have that 10 years ago. It was harder to get data. Today, everyone has a data problem, which is different. The second thing is we are finally at a scale of computing with the high end of what we're doing, where we can start to apply some of the machine learning methods, the deep learning, the approaches of extracting features from data, which were simply impossible. And it's the confluence of these two things, data and computing, that are really changing the tide and opening this to everybody. There is a remarkable startup community that's developing because of this. You know, I was talking, I go out and I talk to these small companies. There was a time, for example, in the early 90s when we were churning through the next generation of supercomputers, and there were these massively parallel machines, lots of companies, thinking machines, were, you know, among the mix. There were dozens and dozens of companies. I had a colleague who collected all the mugs of failed companies, and he had a wall full of these things, of the ones that came and went because of the innovative churn. Some went away, some were bought up. We're in the same place in AI. There are a lot of companies now that are designing chips that do AI specifically remarkably well. You know, you can get 40 or 50 or more petaflops on a chip, things that would, you know, fill a room a couple of times this size at a significant investment. 40 petaflops on a chip is pretty remarkable for AI performance. This is one of many companies now. As you think about AI, the startup world is huge. Forbes estimates the growth of this market to go to about $3 to $6 trillion a year in all sectors. Because data is everywhere, everyone has data. You can buy a smart toothbrush now, which senses your mouth and tells you where to brush. You know, you can get smart coffee mugs, right? I've seen these at the Apple store that are Wi-Fi enabled and will heat and tend to your needs. It's, you know, everything, it is simple with data to train. And right now the innovation is really driven by the private sector because there is such market pull, which is why you see AI in almost every sentence when you walk down the street or go on the metro or watch the television. There's leadership coming from adversarial countries that we certainly think about in terms of data aggregation and what people can do with that data. And there's a growing gap of expertise, and there are things that we believe have to be in the government's domain to do. But it is a rich and dynamic world that will have to be done through partnerships. The administration today has recognized this. There is a new executive order that came out earlier this year on maintaining U.S. leadership in AI, which is similar to the National Strategic Computing Initiative in terms of empowering agencies to forge ahead. We've had guidance from OMB, so the administration has recognized the important pull in this space and that we have to get behind it as aggressively as possible, and this is something that we're doing. But with every technology is a downside, you know, and this is an interesting space that is also emergent. You know, think about AI today as the internet was in the 80s and 90s as it was developing, and no one really thought about cybersecurity. You know, it was just great sending emails, the initial web pages that came up initially when, you know, people had web pages, you could go into their root accounts and you could look at everything. I mean, it was a totally unprotected time when the web was coming up. Even in the Yeah, late 90s, early 2000s, before things, people got smarter. But as we're dealing with this kind of data, as we're dealing with important problems, as we're developing technologies, the question is, how do we get ahead of it? AI today is pretty fragile. You can fool it in many spectacular ways. And there's a growing literature on it. You know, people have showed that in identifying photographs, excuse me, you can alter a single pixel and have it classified as something entirely different. So, you know, one pixel you will never detect. Someone has shown in you know, the detection of cancer cells, tumorous cells, that there was a method proved 95% whether cells were cancerous. This was earlier this year. But they did a small change, and it could predict 95% that they're not. You know, and so it would go from one way to the other. There are interesting ways to misidentify. There are people who have looked at face recognition and developed 3D printable glasses, glass frames, so something that anyone could print. So they demonstrated you could do that, and they ran it through the best facial recognition methods. And if you're wearing the glasses, you can do several things. You could misidentify. So I think one of them was to show whoever was wearing them as Brad Pitt. You could misidentify that way. You know, so you can impersonate, you could identify as anybody, you could even become invisible, because you could fool the AI into thinking there's no one there, so there's nothing to worry about. There are ways people have looked at, in terms of self-driving cars, putting a post-it on a stop sign in a way to fool the recognition to say that's not a stop sign, that's a speed limit sign. And so, you know, there are a lot of interesting examples. So if you're driving, you'd want to know if that's a stop sign or not. But defeating AI in clever ways is problematic. You can, treat it to have it ignore visual objects. If you have access to people's data, or the raw data, you can poison it by biasing it in subtle ways. If people have learned something from the data and extracted a model that they say this is the learned content, you could reverse engineer what that model might be and figure out how to defeat it and trick it so that it doesn't cue on the signals it should be. So you can easily bypass it. If it's access to a facility or whatever, sure, you're granted, you're okay. And so there are interesting things here that are part of trying to surface this as we are developing the technologies. There is one where they printed a turtle, and it's always identified, no matter from what angle, as a rifle. You know, so there is a growing collection of literature of ways to fool AI in subtle ways, but that are fairly robust. And this is something that I think further defines why we have to be invested in this. We have a lot of critical missions. There are decisions we have to make. We're increasingly buried in data. We have to know what we're making. If we're going to base decisions on data, we have to know what's under the hood. We have to know how much we can trust it. It can't just be taken to chance. But we have the opportunity, as AI is developmental right now in terms of hardware and software and all the methodologies, to figure out how to make it more robust so that we can do something interesting with it. Now, there are two things, or three more things I want to touch on just before I finish. Kind of some examples. Former secretary talked about Veterans Affairs. So we started an effort with the Department of Veterans Affairs that we're continuing. We host veterans data the first time the VA has had data outside of their control. Well, it's out of their immediate facilities, still under their control at our facilities. It's health records from 24 million veterans, health records that go back to the early to mid 90s. It is genomic data from the million veterans programs. It's images and text records. And some of the interesting questions that surfaced in talking to the VA, for example, we had a meeting last year, we were talking to them, and the doctors would say that when we prescribe more than five drugs to a patient, the health state declines, kind of a rule of thumb. No one has ever looked at the data and asked, well, what is the relationship to the patient health trajectories, to the kinds of drugs? We can take the data set, we can pull a billion prescriptions out of that and look at that. We can link it to the genomics or health records or BMI or blood pressure or pick your thing. And the question is, what can you learn from that? We're looking at suicide risk, prostate cancer, cardiovascular, starting to look at opioids and addiction issues and in this data set. But it's a very rich data set. And learning from that is non-trivial. It's certainly more than people can do. And so this is a right kind of domain to test skills on how you integrate these kinds of modalities of data to learn something from. We're pushing pretty hard on traumatic brain injury. We have the world's richest data set also on TBI with images and so on. And we found already that beyond three categories of TBI, which are currently used as mild, moderate, and severe, we see 30 kinds that have kind of been learned from the data. We find different modalities, a lot of interesting work going on here, but it's kind of a sense that aggregating this kind of data and learning from it are important and non-trivial. When it comes to patterns of life, something may be closer here. There are interesting questions here. When we talk about these kinds of problems, the number of people we have in the room is much smaller. We like the bigger collaborations that touch many experts outside because the data curation piece, the understanding the data is really non-trivial. It's a big part of the whole problem. But we like to take those tools and see how they go into this. You know, if you can take sensor data and signals data, transaction data and maps and other kinds of image information and aggregate them together with the best subject matter expert models, can you discern patterns of life and distill from that when something has changed, when use of facilities, when different kinds of things are going on than has typically happened before? And the ability to fuse data more than just having an analyst cross-correlate things and try and learn more subtle signatures that could be in data is an important part of that. But it's not hard to find these in just about everything we do. So this is a multi-lab effort we have going, but I think it's also an interesting place. The last example I just had to say because we, go back to the National Cancer Institute work. The effort that you started with Doug Lowy back in 2015 is still going. One of the pilot efforts that we're looking at is an interesting way to do multi-scale molecular dynamics. Molecular dynamics is a method to follow atomistically how particles move to figure out what's happening from the microscopic understanding at the large scale. It's just hard to do with very big samples. We've found ways to inject machine learning and AI into molecular dynamics so we can study the problem of rat sarcoma. The RAS protein is responsible for most of the worst cancers. It's one of these things that it turns on cell division and there are no inhibitors to turn it off. It's been a grand challenge problem for the cancer field for many years. We're still tied to them. They're doing experiments, but we're able to study complex proteins at a macro scale and do machine learning down to atomistics to understand new things and behaviors of RAS proteins and how they trigger the cell division for these cancers. But anyway, that was started with you and Doug. It's going well, and we're pretty happy with it. Last slide. Just to wrap up here. It's an interesting time. It's the Wild West in AI. Anyone with data is applying it. It's misused quite a bit if you're fitting a line through points. People will call it AI these days. If you're optimizing something, people will call it AI. If you're doing something that was called statistics before, today it's called AI because people will fund it. And so you have to separate what's real and what's not. What are the hard problems that you are pushing understanding forward on and what you're not? You know, is it big data? Is it complex multimodal data? Are you applying deep learning? Are you trying to understand features in the data that were not understood? It is going to make an impact. It is here to stay. One way or another, it'll be in everything we do. It's unavoidable. It's already impacting all of you. It's only going to get better as it gets broader. As we put it into the decision cycle of what we do, as we try and base real decisions that mean something, we have a lot of work to do to trust it, to understand when it's when you can decide to do something based on what you've learned. That is not a black box activity. This is very non-trivial, but this is a great place for our national laboratories. I think because of the vulnerabilities, because of the limitations, we can't just be a customer. The kinds of problems we have are deeper than what Amazon or Facebook or Microsoft or the big companies are going to do. The complexity of the data we have is different. And because of that, as we think of our problems, we're going to have to really do quite a bit in partnership with the private sector and academia, but there is a pretty big piece that will fall on us to do, and that's what we're trying to get our head around. And it'll make a difference. I mean, this stuff is important. It's here to stay. It's, you know, again, with the remarkable computing you can hold in your hand, it's going to be embedded everywhere. You know, at home, my home is not a smart home, but even with, the few things I have now, there are probably 20 or 30 different things, smart devices, from appliances to thermostats and phones and smart cameras and so on. It's not going to be long before there are hundreds and thousands in all of our homes, because everything you're going to buy is going to be embedded with something that'll need to talk to somewhere else and pass data somewhere. And that's coming. You're not going to be able to avoid it. And having to manage that is not going to be trivial. From your door locks and everything you can think about, you're going to want a little better. Because ultimately, this impacts quality of life, right? People want this because life gets simpler when a lot of this is done for you. And there is a big demand signal for that. But we haven't figured out what it means to us. And getting our head around what we can trust, how we do it, what makes sense, this is the right time before it's suddenly everywhere and then, what does this mean? So this is, I think, a big undertaking, but this is an important thing to do, and I think it'll touch everything you do here as well. So thank you anyway for coming to share this. Happy to take it.
Can you say,
Ernie?
I need
the mic. Oh, all right. Mitchie, what can you say? Maybe the answer is not much about AI and the nuclear weapons program.
So, there's going to be an important piece of AI as we think about where simulation goes. So, here's one of the challenges. We'll run a big simulation, and 100, 200, 300, $500 million computers today. We will run them for weeks or months on a calculation. It's a lot of money. The advertised cost of that is not trivial. It'll create petabytes of numerical data. Okay, so we have a lot of numerical data simulating something we think is important, but we have to validate it against the physical world. We are doing exquisitely instrumented experiments now. You know, thousands of channels of data, orders of magnitude in time, rich, complex data from experiments, from subcritical experiments, from NIF, from hydro shots, from pick your data source. How do you compare the two? You know, how do you match all of the numerical data to all of the experiment to say, this is how much I trust the answer? You know, right now it comes down to fitting a line, dots with error bars. You distill it to a few degrees of freedom where you compare an equation of state, you compare something, there is no way that we know right now to embed all the data, dynamical information, multi-scale experimental information into the code to validate everything that is going on. And so one of the things that we have to try to get to is to go from where we're doing high-performance computing today to embed the data and the learning so that as we're running the code, we can learn against the data and understand how good the models are at that moment and see if we can aggregate uncertainty. I think as we get, you know, exascale systems are going to have exabytes of data. If you thought a petabyte is bad, you know, a trillion photos a day, it's a lot of data. And if you have that experimentally and numerically, the only way I can see of trying to understand the veracity of any prediction is to merge those worlds and draw in the learning and the data into the simulation in a smart way. And I think that's going to be a main challenge. If we can do that, we will change the definition of what simulation means. And I think we'll be far more reliable in the kinds of things we'll be able to predict in the future.
Just to move that a little bit further along, one of the, I'm involved with a small fusion company, TAE. But the point is there was, actually there's a been a collaboration with Google and paper published about, because similar to NIF or maybe DART, et cetera, these machines where, you know, you got to take repetitive shot after shot after shot, and the question is how the hell do you decide what the next shot should be? So this paper, this is about using AI in that context as a decision assist to guide the experimental program. Is any of that going on in the stewardship program?
Yes. So when the Trinity machine was started up at Los Alamos, the Livermore team ran a lot of 2D simulations of NIF capsule implosions. I forget, you know, a million simulations of different things. And they created a rich database, which I think they're making some of that open source, of all the different ways a capsule can implode. And then the question was, can we learn from that the implosion pathways? Because we've always believed that a symmetric implosion of a capsule is the best way. And what they learned from the data, using machine learning on this data set, was that there are pathways that are asymmetric, that you want to implode them with lobes in different ways, and you can get more yield from that. So 2D codes, you know, nothing is perfect there, but at least it showed them off the bat that there are non-intuitive things that could exist that test our core beliefs on the best way to do things. And part of their goal will be to see whether that's really realizable. So, yeah, some of that's going on, but it's showing early promise in terms of telling us things that we just didn't think were true.
Yeah, true. Just a quick one is the audience. When I was at DOE, we started asking, okay, the Advanced Strategic Computing Initiative. And I proudly learned what a terror flop was. Okay? And now you're talking not only petaflops, but exascale. Give people some understanding of the power of this high-performance computing.
Yeah, we throw around these numbers, and they're really no good measure. So a petaflop is doing 10 to the 15, so one with 15 zeros, mathematical operations per second. We have systems now that are close to 200 petaflops, so, you know, they're 20% of an exaflop, which is our next goal, which is one with 18 zeros. Now, the universe, you know, is 10 to the 18 seconds old, you know, from the Big Bang to today. We do 10 to the 18, we will be doing 10 to the 18 math operations per second. You know, how you make sense out of all these numbers, I don't know. You can compare to the number of laptops or the number of phones or whatever, but there's staggering amounts of mathematical capability that these systems have. If you're asking the right kind of questions to look at, it's just
how efficient is it? as you're scaling up?
It depends. So that's a problem dependent.
On a standard.
Yeah, you know, there are some problems that just don't lend themselves well to the architecture because they're limited. We can speed up processing. The thing that takes time that we can't speed up is moving electrons through wires. You know, we eventually have a big room-sized system, and to send signals between boards and things, we have wires, or maybe we even have photonics, and it's speed of light limited. But there's a certain latency, slowness built in, and if your simulations require a lot of communication between the different parts of the computer when you run it on the big system, you take a hit. There are other kinds of applications that just scream on these systems. They're very high efficiency. So, you know, balancing the load of what you're solving against the architecture is an important part of this because, you know, every bit of performance is important.
Thank you, Dr. Kusnezov. My name is Paul Lee, and I'm from the Asia program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. So I had a question about, you had a slide about the race for global partnerships and adversaries as well. And actually, we're launching a project that looks at U.S.-Japan alliance cooperation on defense equipment and also on, you know, high technologies. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about opportunities and challenges from a technical point of view, as well as from a policy point of view about, you know, what the Department of Energy could do with other countries and allies and partners like Japan, and also with adversaries like China and Russia as well.
Yeah, so I would say partnerships, the international piece is going to be important. It was spelled out in the executive order. We signed a statement of intent to work in AI with the French. There's been certainly an agreement with the UK. We're talking with the Norwegians. We're talking with people about these because the problems are hard. You know, at the end of the day, all of us, whichever country you live in, we're all faced with the same short list of problems that worry us. And we have more problems than we have solutions. And we don't know where the best answers are going to come from. And we don't have a monopoly on the best ideas. And finding the best way to partner with people, you know, a lot of this is data driven. Finding the right data sets, wherever they may be, the right people who can think broadly about how to learn from data, the right places to innovate, who's doing what in technology. You know, when we talk with the startup companies, these are, you know, 100, 150 people companies that are just a bunch of people who tape out a new chip or a design and they fab it at TSMC, you know, in Taiwan. You know, a lot of these are fabulous companies that have ideas, and those ideas can come from anywhere. And so, again, there is no monopoly on best ideas here, but I think we do share largely a common short list of problems, and finding the right partners who want to step up and work these problems is part of the strategy.
Actually, as he's walking over, what about AI competition with China? What's your take on that?
Oh, it is a challenge. So, being the Wild West in technology right now, we worry about IP. You know, we talk with small companies, and you look to see who are the venture backers behind it. You'll see Baidu and Tencent, and you know, pick your company. They're all there. You know, they're investing huge amounts of money across the board in all ideas, and that's just you know, the world we're in right now. The companies won't shun the funds, and as they try and develop their technologies, you know, being there early to find things that make sense for our missions will be important, to pick and choose things that can help. And we want to be there before the dust settles, before IP is lost, so we can try and at least push the best ideas forward from here. It is a race against the clock, and we do think about that. Plus the data aggregation challenge, you know, where there's more central ability to aggregate data in other countries than we might have. And what that means, well, you can think that through yourself, but it is.
One issue you didn't address would be what I would call the space odyssey problem. I'm sure we've all seen the movie. You know, the computer goes rogue, decides to take over. Whenever I read about AI, I read about this, where years we're going to have societal benefits, as you had. But down the road, if the computers can think for themselves, if they can communicate with each other, won't they get the idea that they want to take over from us? Is that a real threat, or is that just a science fiction movie?
It is hard to see that world for me yet. You know, today it is a fragile and hard undertaking to try and learn anything, let alone, you know, have a conversation or find something, you know, have it think whatever that might be. So, you know, with the fragility that I certainly see now, I don't know how you'd get there. You know, I don't know where HAL is, you know, in our thinking, or Skynet, or pick your form here. You know, I would not put AI into a critical system right now to do something automatically for me, because I would worry about whether I could trust what it was going to do. Doesn't preclude you from doing that. I just wouldn't. And so, you know, you could do things that probably wouldn't be smart, but to have the system do it on its own, I think is still, I don't know how you get there.
Quick question. I think it was chart 13, you showed how this could possibly be applied to the nonproliferation mission. And at first, when I saw that chart, I thought it was a notional chart, and then you described it more as something that's actually happening.
Yeah.
How would you characterize, and it's obviously in its early stage, maybe not, but how would you characterize the maturity of the work in this area and how rich the future is? Because ultimately, I mean, this is clearly a mission of this organization and something of interest to all of us.
Well, I think first, it is surfacing things to think about. You know, it's still nascent. You know, the problem is correlations or complex relationships in data can be subtle. They might be real, they might not be real. And we'll probably have a lot of fits and starts and false positives that'll have to be worked through. It's not a matter of just trusting what comes out of this, but these things already surface things that, oh, okay, what does that mean? And kind of the needle in the haystack kind of thing that you didn't realize the data had these kinds of signals in it, but it does. And so the more data you get, the more that will surface. But this is kind of our unavoidable future. You know, if we're not doing this, it would be a real mistake. This is something we have to do, and smarter ways to surface subtle correlations in the data. So it's going on. There is data. It's multimodal. People are applying learning methods to it. And this cycle is already happening.
Okay.
And it'll just get better in time.
You want to say a word about our project or
not?
Yeah, you might not be able to say much.
No, well,
Yeah.
I'll just mention that we've started a small project with a organization here in town that is all about gathering data and trying to make sense of it as it relates to trade in products of interest for nonproliferation, for example. I guess all I'll say about that project is that data is the long pole in the tent. You know, do you have the data that then you can apply these tools to? And so actually a question for you is, in the Department of Energy programs, in addition to thinking about AI itself, is there a companion data program where you're going to try to figure out where you can, you know, scour the world for data of interest and relevance to DOE's mission so that you can then apply some of these tools?
There isn't, but that'll have to be part of it. We do have now a chief data officer role in the department, but how we think about data broadly across missions, across classifications, across all of this is not trivial. And the data piece again is, don't us underestimate how hard that is in terms of its incompleteness, its fuzziness, all the things. You know, in looking, for example, at the veterans' health data, and in the health records, the number of different ways lab tests are reported in the health record. So if you go in for your lab test, there are 400,000 different ways lab tests are reported in the VA health records. And they're not all distinct. And there are redundancies and personal ways of doing things and complexities, because humans ultimately, generated data in ways, and trying to understand this is not simple. And so data experts, it's not just about where's the data. You need the expertise. There's a lot of data out there that's of absolutely no use. There are people who have looked at rich images and data, and they, for example, said, here's a structure, and it was the software used to put the label right on the structure. But that, of course, was no use because it obscures the structure. So why don't we put it to the side here? And so you have rich image data sets that have information with a data vision that analysts will be looking at this. If you want to apply learning, completely useless, because the structure is not geotagged. And so, if you're trying to understand, you might read where what it is, but you don't know where in the picture to identify so you can learn and train on that kind of structure. And so there are all kinds of data sets that are rich, annotated, taken, great care of, and are totally useless. And so as I think about the data issue, it's not about the data we can get today or how we do machine learning or AI today. The question is, what are we going to need in 10 years' time? If we're going to be archiving and getting the right kind of data, how do we ensure that it is robust enough to satisfy the perceived needs of whatever learning is going to be on the next generation of tools? How to open that aperture up is not obvious. So it's the data piece is really interesting, but it's new in that capacity, and we don't have the answers yet on how to get our heads around that.
Thank you for an interesting presentation. My name is Henrik. I'm with the Partnership for Global Security. And I had a question relating what you said about the partnerships with private sector and academia. I'm not too familiar with US policymaking, so this is going to have a European undertone to it. But what I was wondering was that, what's also unique about AI is how complex it is. And in regard to how government creates policies in this field, is that they often consult with expert groups. And these groups range from academic groups to NGOs to professional groups that all have their own agenda and interest in these policies. So my question is, do you see a problem in how policies influenced by a certain community, or how is this in the US? Because if you need recommendations, you go to a certain one group to get advice, right? And then that also means that group will have influence on the policies, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so data use is really complicated, and there is no good answer to that. With the European privacy laws, especially now, it's interesting and complex. I think a lot of this is going to be unnatural for many people. The value of AI comes from amassing and learning from huge amounts of data. You take the healthcare space again. The way that you access healthcare data traditionally through a hospital, through a medical study, is you apply for, you know, specific kind of information that's narrowly defined, and you get an IRB to review it and make sure that it's consistent with the need, and then you can, you know, draw in that data and do your work. You know, the challenge we ran into with trying to work AI methods with the Department of Veterans Affairs, for example, is that model for approval of access to data and use doesn't work. You know, with AI, we want to access all the data, and we want to look at everything at one time, and we want to see what's in there. And so it turns understanding on its head, and, you know, then people start to worry about risk. You know, why should you look at everything? You know, and so there is a fair amount of learning that is going to have to happen for people to appreciate what you can achieve if you, you know, bring the right kinds of data together and learn from it. You know, what the intersection is with policy remains to be seen. It's more complicated than that because, you know, we worry about biases. We worry about how it affects privacy and civil rights. And, you know, we did this interesting study on big data back in 2014, which surfaced, a lot of this in what isn't data. You know, when you think about policies, well, you know, what are trigger points of what people will worry about? And already at that time, there were interesting examples which have kind of become canonical today. You know, there was the learning that Target was doing at the time in terms of monitoring habits of people buying things. And there was a customer that they determined was pregnant. They sent coupons to her house. I don't know if don't remember if it was diapers or prenatal vitamins, but it was certainly caused the parents of the young lady who was a minor to complain to Target, you know. And then they found out that way that their daughter was pregnant. And so, you know, it's a privacy issue that surfaced in an innocuous way at looking at buying habits and sending value to the customer. Here's some coupons. We determine you're going to need prenatal and so, you know, whose responsibility is that? Is it in the data? Is it, you know, who do you need to think about the right policies to help you understand whether you're crossing the line? With civil rights, it was a similar thing. You know, there was the entry page. If you wanted to apply to Xerox, corporation for a job, they had an entry page where you'd fill out the questionnaire, and if you passed the survey, they would eventually, the next round went to talking to a person. And it was based on their data, and what they were interested in is, you know, the employees that would have the longest longevity at their company. You know, it's the right kind of question. We should hire people who are going to stay. And what it ended up doing is it filtered out all the people from the underrepresented communities that were farther away. All the people that it preferentially favored people who lived in the right neighborhoods close to the facility. And so if you were not affluent enough to live there, you never had a chance at getting a job there. And that's more of a civil rights issue. And so, you know, as you think about data, first, what are the biases in it? You think about the questions you're asking of the data. Whose responsibility is it? Is it those who have the data? Is it those writing code? I mean, people writing code say it's just code, right? I mean, there's no bias. It's just asking the right question of the data. And when you put all these pieces together, the policy space becomes much more non-intuitive. And finding our way through that, the more learning we do, the more data we aggregate, the more it touches our everyday lives, is going to be a very complicated and challenging affair. And we're going to run into it one way or another. So I don't know the answer to your question.
But good start.
Is there one last question? Over there.
Catherine Dill from the Center for Nonproliferation Studies. It strikes me that there's an additional type of risk as well, and that's of false negatives. Right? So in a case like this, I'd just be curious about your current thinking on how to address that?
Yeah, you know, again, it's this, how do you decide and prove? I think that's an unsolved problem. Right now, when you go to Google and you put in a search term or you look for something, I don't know if you click, I feel lucky, and you'll just take the first one, or you're satisfied with paging through and refining your search and knowing that most of your time is with the wrong hits. You know, we tolerate today in the smart methods that touch us a lot of false positives and negatives. And we have kind of a tolerance because it doesn't matter too much. You know, and it's complicated in many ways. So the cancer cell one was, you know, even if you can explain how you get from the data to a decision, something people call explainable AI, it was a demonstration that the same methods with data that looked effective, identical to the radiologist, to the specialist, just a slight modification of some pixels, but looks the same otherwise, is fully confident that it's cancerous or fully confident it's not. In either case, you could trace from the data through the AI to the false positive or the false negative. And so, you know, the answer is we don't know, other than work has to be done to figure out how much we trust it. And so you'll see all the great stories out there, you know, with AlphaGo and chess and StarCraft and all the different places that AI is doing remarkable things in playing games and solving problems and you know, beating the Stanford test and, you know, pick your thing. But there's a lot of other sides that people don't talk about too. And being aware of that, being skeptical and asking the right questions and trying to develop a sense of what certainty means is to be developed. And there aren't a lot of market forces for that. And that's going to be the challenge. And that's going to be a place that we have to play because we're going to care about that. But a lot of other places, it doesn't matter if your hotel choice that it recommends is not exactly the one you want. Well, you go to, you know, you scroll down until you find the one you like. That's okay for those things. But no one knows the answer to those questions right now on how we separate those. But we'll need to.
Despite having had the last question, Laura insists upon
coming. I just have a question that your answer spawns, which is, are the team, is it your judgment that the teams working on these, answering these kind of connected questions are diverse enough to be, I mean, what you're talking about is philosophy at some level. What is, you know, what is true enough? I don't trust a bunch of, you know, hoodie wearing computer techs in Santa Rosa to be ready to answer that question.
Yeah,
I don't know California geography very well. So how do we, and what role does the energy department as a policy driver of this, not just a consumer, have to contribute to the diversity of the community that is wrestling with this problem? Is that worthy, boss?
Yes.
Okay.
We are gender champions here.
I'm talking about intellectual diversity.
No. Let's do this way.
Yeah.
It's also the answer.
Look, there are real challenges here, but being at the formative stage of doing this is the right time to ask these kinds of questions. You know, right now, Secretary Perry is fully behind trying to figure all of this out and having that kind of top cover to push areas that we haven't really delved into before. New areas in the data side and asking these kinds of questions requires that. You know, doing things that are new is always hard. But I think we're at the right place to start asking these questions. You know, these are hard questions. I don't know what the answers are. You know, if I had the answers, I'd start a company and you know, it would be easy to figure out what
Make
to do
bug.
Next. These are the right kinds of questions to ask. Don't take AI for granted. Trust. We don't know what trust means yet with these systems. You know, and you'll run into that with autonomous vehicles. You know, for those that have Teslas, you know, some people put it into the self-driving mode, but they still keep their hands next to the steering wheel. But if you can fool a stop sign with a Post-it, you know, I'm sure the Tesla software is better than that. So I don't mean to suggest there's, but you know, it is coming into affect our lives directly already with how much we trust it in doing things. And we're going to be faced with this the easy way or the hard way, you know, by learning from examples where, wow, we really need to fix this. And we don't want to be in a mode where we're simply doing triage. You know, we've been doing triage in cyber for you know, decades now, because the next threat, the next technology opens up the door to much more. And every year it's the same thing. We have to get ahead of this by asking these kinds of questions and not dropping it to as an afterthought, as a fix later on. Beyond that, I don't know where the answer is going to lie. You know, I hope we get there in terms of trust, but it can't be trusting that the programmers or the data is right. It can't be that. It's got to be something different.
Okay, well, let's thank Dimitri for